Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another Fantastic Monday with me, John Arola, or at least what's left of me, and Francesca Fiorentini. Francesca, how's it going?
I'm so glad I'm not doing your job today, John. It's going
great. You've done my job a lot lately, so let's thank you for that. I came back from my trip to Missouri a little bit sick, and it got worse. It wasn't COVID, so let's stop with the conspiracy theories. I'm just a baby is basically all that it is. But yeah, so Francesca took over on Thursday, Brett took over on Friday. Thank you to both of you for doing this job, especially after filling in for like a whole week for me.
I think it was Wednesday, Thursday, but you know, who's counting? It's fine.
Twice as much. Okay, well, thank you for that. Again, appreciate it.
I'm glad you're better, John. It's good to be here. Happy Monday, y'all. That's all I've got.
I had a lot of time off and very little ability to enjoy it. So that's cool. But anyway, thank you for doing that. Thank you, everybody, for you know, sticking with the show while I was gone and enjoying you know, while I was gone. You guys got to have fun, bring in cool guests I've never done the show with before and everything. So that's fun. Still sick. So we'll see what happens with my voice. I can feel I'm gradually getting more and more Phoebe during Smelly Cat. So that's gonna be fun. That's something to look forward to. Something else to look forward to, a lot of nonsense. That is the theme of the show today. I haven't really been able to comment on the news. So over the past 5 days or so, I've been like accruing links of just absolute nonsense I wanna cover. So we have a lot of that coming up for you. And along the way, as we run through this nonsense, if you wouldn't mind hitting the like button, sharing the stream, that'd be great. And we'll be responding to your comments as we go. That said, before we jump into the news, Francesca, what's been up with the Bituation Room?
Oh my God, thanks for asking. We had a show last night that was amazing. We talked about 10 years since Occupy Wall Street and why and how it popped off and how it led to all the kinds of social movements we're seeing now, even if they didn't have concrete demands or any, you know, real leaders that sort of ran for office. That like all of that is like the origin story of things like, you know, the squad, origin story of things like DSA. So anyway, it was a great conversation. So watch that at Franny Fio on my YouTube channel or listen back as a podcast. It was super good. And we have like a bonus part of that discussion. Ooh. On Patreon. So, because, you know,
that's fun. Yes, no, I'm glad that you look back over that history. We're gonna be talking a little bit later about the current state of trying to get the government to do literally anything. So that's gonna be fun. But that's a different sort of nonsense. We'll be talking about wine moms soon enough. Don't worry about that. But first, other nonsense. Let's launch directly into this.
Yesterday, we also got the results of the Arizona audit, which were so disgracefully reported by those people right back there in the headlines claiming that Biden won. That Biden won are fake news and a very big lie. You know, they like to, do you ever notice when they write about that, they would say, while the election results are a big lie, every reporter, it's just total misinformation. While they're totally unfounded, everything's unfounded, big lie, not correct. While Trump has no reason to say this, I mean, we got piles and piles of information, affidavits by the thousands and thousands. It's a disgrace. We won on the Arizona forensic audit yesterday at a level that you wouldn't believe.
No, no, you didn't. Despite your piles of information, I went to grad school, so you know I appreciate a good pile of information.
Of affidavits, lots of
and
affidavits.
And thousands of them. They won at a level you'd never, like that's, okay, so why are we talking about this? So the results came out on Friday, or they were like previewed last Thursday night. And the preview was that this ongoing audit in Arizona by the cyber ninjas, the elite strike force, was going to show that in fact, the election in Arizona had not been stolen, that Biden had actually won. In advance of that though, so the results were supposed to come out on Friday. And Trump responded to the initial reporting saying, oh, they're trying to get out in front of this, but don't worry. Once the full report is out, it's gonna prove that we were right. And that didn't happen. And so what did it find? The probe found that a hand recount of nearly 2.1 million ballots was basically the same result as the initial. It was actually a little bit worse for Trump. The hand recount for Biden exceeded the county's tally by 99 votes. Trump received 261 fewer votes than the official results. So not only was it not stolen, but it was actually slightly more of a Biden win than they thought. That's it. That's the result of millions of dollars in this months-long recount. I will remind you, the election was like 325 days ago. So just bear that in mind. The end result, Biden won by a little bit more than we thought. And so no, they're not gonna learn anything from that. He just went to his rally after that came out and said it proved that we in fact won. But that isn't what it proved. But Francesca, nothing matters. Like, they know that. They would have been crowing about it if it had somehow shown that Arizona was stolen, but it didn't. And nobody will learn absolutely anything about it. And in fact, it's just gonna become, we're gonna talk about it moving to other states as well. But I mean, I know you're not surprised, but I don't, like, what are we supposed to do? This is all leading to them actually trying to steal an election next time. And we're seemingly defenseless, even though we're proven right over and over and over again.
Right. I mean, exactly. Whether you're a MAGA, you know, Republican, or whether you're, you know, sort of like cool on Trump, and you're in like the state senate and Arizona state senate. A lot of them who were like, I don't know about these cyber ninja guys. I mean, yes, let's do the audit, but like, they've never done this before. They're given weird interviews. They're being, you know, subpoenaed essentially by like Congress. Like, maybe they don't know what they're doing, and then they produce these results. Right, that basically verify their elections. And so they don't know what to do. They don't know whether to say, like, I mean, imagine you're an Arizona Republican, like, yes, our state's voting systems are completely bunk, or, you know, or no, they're perfectly fine and they're wrong. Like, it was unclear what they wanted to happen. What we imagined would happen was that they would somehow find some phantom votes and basically claim fraud. Instead, something even more mind-boggling and insane happened, which is that people who never did an audit found out essentially what the official voter, you know, certification also found out, which is that Biden won and Trump lost. So good on them, first time audit. Hey, you know, beginner's luck, you got it right. And instead of accepting those numbers, either accepting those numbers or saying that Cyber Ninja had no idea what they were doing, because obviously they didn't, you know, and saying, no, this audit is wrong. No, we need a new audit, the new audit that shows that Trump won. Instead, they're saying reality, which what you see here is also wrong. So that Cyber Ninja and the data that they gave only proves that Trump won and that there was fraud, but it doesn't. It's like every single turn that you wanna make as a Republican, you're like, how would I play this? They play it completely opposite the way you would think you would play it if you were them. Because when reality doesn't matter, you're just making it up. You're just saying, oh yeah, you know, the votes that show that Biden win, that show that Trump won. Anyway,
yeah.
How about breakfast?
And look, basically what's going on, and has been going on for 325 days, is varying levels of copium. It's just they're sad that they lost and they need to feel better, but there are actual different levels. Like, Fox News on Friday did not report on the Arizona audit results. Like, they just pretended that it didn't happen, because there's nothing, well, aside from what Trump demonstrated, because that's the best you can do with that. Like, there's a special class of needy, copium addicted Republicans that go to those rallies that just want Trump to say we won, even though we didn't. He's standing there saying, we won. You lost the election on election day. You lost all of your legal challenges to it. You lost your bid to decertify the election. You lost your bid to storm the Capitol and stop Biden from becoming president. Now you did your audit and you didn't win that either. Saying you won is literally meaningless, but they still need it. And so they still cheer for it. And it's a level beyond even what most Republicans, including his allies in Fox News, are willing to do, because they literally didn't even want to touch this thing because it is so embarrassing at this point. And I have no doubt that people like Sean Hannity and Tucker Carlson never thought that the Arizona audit was going to uncover massive fraud. They know that this is a grift. And they're not journalists truly, so they feel no need to actually report accurately on what's going on, to even cover the fact that this audit turned up nothing. And so Trump just goes off to his echo chamber and whines about it. And for the most part, it is meaningless. It's not affecting our lives today, but he is sustaining an audience of people that just want to win, and they are demonstrating every day. They don't care at all about reality. They don't care about anything 1,000 miles from reality. They want to be in charge, and he almost certainly will run again. They're going to have more control over the election systems of multiple states than they did in 2020. And so while right now this is largely irrelevant and it's nonsense and it's fun times and all that, it is going to become incredibly consequential when they have the secretaries of state that they need and the state legislatures they need and the election laws they need to not only do audits afterward as copium, but to literally overturn the results of elections at the state level. That is what they're preparing for right now. And I cover this like feeling in my gut that there's nothing we're doing about it. There's seemingly nothing we can do about it. It's just going to happen next time. And we have years of notice, and there's nothing we can do. Certainly nothing that is being done. We can't even get the For the People Act passed at the federal level, despite Democrats having unified control of the entire federal government. We can't do anything.
No, and the reason we can't do anything is comes right back down to the state of Arizona, right? And fittingly, the fact that Kyrsten Sinema, Senator Kyrsten Sinema, is not going to be in favor for filibuster reform in order to do things like pass the For the People Act and protect and enshrine voting rights around this country to prevent state lawmakers like the Arizona Republicans from doing these kind of sham audits, and then no matter what the outcome, using them to obliterate the remaining amount of voting rights that the state of Arizonans have. So again, it is incredible the way that corporate Democrats are in lockstep when it comes to the ultimate goal, which is minority rule. And look, that could be minority rule of Republicans, or that could be minority rule, the consensus is, of the 1% of corporations, of people with power and money to buy our democracy. And so it is cruel to see that the person standing in the way is a Democrat. In all this nonsense, it's a Democrat.
Yeah, they do not have, probably will never have, an actual majority of the country that believes their nonsense. But they don't need to. They've got a system that has always magnified their power beyond its actual numbers, and they have allies. And after our break, we're going to talk about one of those major allies. But we are just cruising down the highway towards full-blown fascism. The bare democracy that we sort of kind of had for some people for a while, even that will be just a memory. But anyway, we should take that first break. No, actually, you know what? We have one more aspect of this story we got to get to, because the fact that the Arizona audit cost millions of dollars and produce nothing except confirmation that the election results were accurate does not mean that they're not going to do any more of those, that they're too embarrassing, they're a waste of time or anything. They're launching directly into another one, literally in the wake of this one, just hours after President Donald Trump, he sent a letter to GOP Texas Governor Greg Abbott. And again, it's so weird that they send letters, literally call him on the phone. You have his number, but he wants to make it public. He demanded an audit of Texas's results. Texas, by the way, is a state that he won. But anyway, so that's nonsense. So it's nonsense because he won the state. It's nonsense because we know these audits only confirm over and over that the results were accurate. The third aspect of nonsense to this, though, is that they're doing it. Secretary of State appear to comply. Thursday evening press release from the office stated that the Secretary of State has the authority to conduct a full and comprehensive forensic audit of any election and has already begun the process. Okay, so this is, we did apparently talk about this on Friday. I apologize, I was not on that show. But I do want to tie it to his commentary over the weekend. They're doing this, or supposedly they're doing this, because local county officials say that they have no idea that this is going on. And really fast, you might say, well, this makes no sense. Why do it? It can't result in him winning. He already won. But again, none of this conversation at this point is about actually changing the results of elections. It's about setting up a system that can change the results of future elections. So you go into these areas where you have complete control at the state level to say and do whatever you want, and then pretend that they messed something up, Democratic areas inside of Texas, and you use that to make sure that Texas doesn't flip. They're doing it right now with their redistricting map. They're gonna end up getting, despite the cities in Texas being the ones that are growing, these are Democratic areas, they're gonna get at least two more seats in the House, and they're going to have two more Republican seats, despite the demographic change in Texas. All of this is connected. It's complete nonsense, but it will be used to pass further anti-democratic legislation.
Yeah, I mean, that's the whole point.
We did talk about it, but what are your thoughts?
No, I mean, the fact that it's going forward is new, right? And also the fact that apparently there is no Secretary of State, I believe, right now in Texas, because the former one resigned because they were like, yeah, the vote was okay. Like the 2020 election results were right on. Now there's like an acting Secretary of State, you know, so this is imploding the Republican Party also, and proving that again, we hate, look, Liz Cheney versus Marjorie Taylor Greene. I know a lot of us are like, well, one paves the way for the other, and that is absolutely 100% right. But at this moment, I am 100% hoping the Republicans show some kind of backbone, just minimal amounts of backbone. And look, Governor Greg Abbott like is someone who's being hounded by, there are people to the right of him imagining that. At what point are you gonna actually stand up to those folks, right? Oh, but that doesn't win you. They resign.
The few Republicans that have stood up to him, they do it to their minimal credit, and then they go off down that dusty trail.
Yeah, and let's not forget, look, there's the fastest growing populations in these states are people of color. They're Latino and Asian American. And not only that, they're the fastest group of voters in the United States are Asian Americans, right? And it's actually one of the fastest growing groups outside of Houston, right? And so this should not be lost on anyone, right? This is, they're playing identity politics, okay? This is about enshrining white minority rule. And it's not about equity. Right? It's because again, there's not more people of color than white people in Texas. Calm down. This is about continuing to sideline folks who they've rested on sidelining for decades, right? Yeah. And now that folks are standing up for themselves and voting out and coming out in numbers, no, we can't have that. That's democracy. Ooh.
Yeah. And again, as we'll get to in the next block, the Democrats could fight back against this, but as of right now, they are doing nothing. So we're gonna take that first break. We're gonna respond to some of your comments. When we come back, we're gonna touch base with this week's infrastructure back and forth and all that after this. Okay, everybody, let's see what other news we've got. Actually, before we jump into the news, let me let you know a few of the things that are going on today. So frequently we will tell you who's gonna be on Indisputable with Dr. Rashad Ritchie. I'll tell you about who they're gonna do a debate with, who the guest is gonna be. I think that they really swung and had a miss today. It's this guy, Michael Moore, apparently makes movies or something. I'm not really familiar with him. He's an Oscar winner. I don't know who Oscar is. But anyway, he's the host of Rumble with Michael Moore podcast. He's gonna be joining Dr. Rashad Ritchie. So of course that should be fun. That's coming up right after our show, but not on our YouTube channel. Go to the Indisputable YouTube channel, obviously. And also want to let you know about some of the content that's coming to Twitch. Tuesdays, deep dive with Jordan Yule at 1 p.m. Pacific time, 4 p.m. Eastern time. So that'll be fun. Thursdays at that same time, you have Ray Actions with Ray Vanna. And Fridays, same time, Galaxy Brain with Ben Carollo. So 1 p.m. Pacific time, 4 p.m. Eastern time is kind of, Twitch is the place to be at that particular time. Now that said, Francesca, you ready to do some more news?
Indeed.
Okay. Kyrsten Sinema. Just can't stand her.
Girl boss.
The hair, the Uggs, the stance on corporate tax rates. Anyway, Kyrsten Sinema
girl boss.
No queen, no. Kyrsten Sinema has new demands for the infrastructure bill, which probably at this point isn't gonna happen. She has told her Democratic colleagues, she doesn't support any tax hikes on corporations or the wealthy. None. So not just like, hey, now we can't bring these back up to where they were at before that insane right wing president we had, because they already weren't going to. They were already only going to raise them a little bit. She is saying none, like nothing. And so I think the name of our, yeah, so the name of our stream is Kyrsten Sinema Quits Pretending. This is like, it's just, she's done with the mask. She's done with the, I'm a Green Party candidate back in the day. Look at my hair, I'm young and progressive and all that. No, she is a like crazy right winger on financial matters and a lot of other stuff too, which we'll get to. This is, and again, she's the moderate. The progressives really have to figure out how to deal with the moderate Dems. What is moderate about this? What is moderate about a Democrat that has a relatively extreme position for a Republican senator at this point? That you literally can never raise taxes on those who are best off in our society. This is a woman who used to talk about how she was going to fight for like the working class of Arizona. She is just there for the richest of the rich, and she's not pretending anymore.
Yeah. And this is also someone who says, we can't reform the filibuster because imagine shoe on the other foot and Republicans are gonna use, you know, their majorities to completely obliterate our rights. And then she turns around and ultimately says, no. You know that sort of right wing hellscape this entire country has been thrust into thanks to, you know, Bush and corporate Obama and Trump and all the tax cuts? Yeah. That rightward slide, she likes it. She likes it right there. It should be over here, maybe in the center, right? She likes how far this country has slid. So there is no inkling in her mind that if she's empowered, which she is, to actually even the playing field, to create more equity, to create more democracy, to actually have more representation for working Americans, for, let's just be real, the majority of Americans, even people making $500,000 are paying more in taxes than 10 people who make $10 million, right? That's wrong in and of itself, even if those people are not necessarily working class. But she is a complete hypocrite, right? She has no intention of doing anything with this because she likes it. She likes where we've gone. So that entire argument of, oh no, what's gonna happen when Republicans are in power? They already are. If you don't undo their agenda, then they've already won and they keep on winning thanks to you.
Yeah, our producers put together some great notes. So she's already taken in $6 million in donations from the finance, insurance, and real estate industry. And we know that that already affected her on things like, Medicare being able to negotiate and things like that. So she already turned on them on the pharma stuff because she was bought. She has been bought. And now it's just a generalized, the rich are my people. I'm not going to let you hurt them. That's it. That's it. And honestly, like we just went through a recall here. And obviously this recall demonstrated how the recall process can be absolute nonsense. And I don't even think that they have anything like that in Arizona, but shouldn't they? Like at a certain point, shouldn't your lies that you use to have gotten elected are so clear, they were so dishonest that you should be able to be recalled by your voters. You blatantly lied to every single voter in Arizona. And like nothing's gonna happen. She's only gotten more influence and they're gonna court her and try to make her feel special. They're gonna send her bottles of rosé and everything. Kick her out of the party, seriously. Biden is the leader of the Democratic Party. And I don't know substantively, like if you don't allow her to caucus with him, she loses her seats in the Senate or you know committee seats or whatever, kick her out of the goddamn party. Yeah. She is an ideological traitor against, and I'm not just saying she's a conservative, she pitched herself as a progressive. She pitched herself as being I'm the new wave of Democrats. She is trying to tank the president's agenda in every way that she possibly can. But Bernie's not even a real Democrat. Remember that? Throw her out of the goddamn party.
Yeah, and I mean, and this is the thing, right? Like if a Republican, you know, sort of vies for her seat, how much you want to bet we're going to be told, oh no, but we can't lose the seat. You know, we have to keep Kyrsten Sinema in there. No, we don't. What's the difference? Honestly, what is the difference, right? This changes, I'm not saying across the board, but in this case, there is no difference between a Republican getting in there and Kyrsten Sinema getting in there, because she is the barrier to progress, just like a Republican would be anyway. And speaking of kicking her out of the party, this weekend, the Arizona Democratic Party actually voted by 80% that if Kyrsten Sinema does not vote to reform the filibuster in the Senate in DC, they have a vote of no confidence in her. So she is essentially out of the party. They don't support her. She's on her own. She's gone rogue.
Well, and her spokesperson was asked if they had a response to that no confidence vote, and they said, we do not. Because why would they have to? They're not responsive to the party. They're responsive to the wealthy donors that are the only people she actually cares about. And the thing is, honestly, if you booted her out, well, maybe a right winger would take over. Well, but see, a right winger would presumably have to campaign as a conservative. And who wants to do that? Not even Kyrsten Sinema would do that. She wouldn't even be honest enough to run as the conservative that she is or isn't. I don't think that she actually had, maybe one day way back, she had some values or something. But now it is just, tell me what I need to do. Give me the money, give me the checks, do the fundraiser for me, and I will vote for whatever you want. Screw the working class of Arizona, screw their minimum wage, screw their democracy. It's not just that they're reaming the rights of people to vote in a bunch, they're doing it in her state. And yeah, she doesn't give a damn.
Not only that though, I think this is really important. And I think that, look, I'm not saying that Joe Biden and Joe Manchin's meeting went well, because we all know it didn't. But Biden talking about, Republicans are gonna have an epiphany. What about your Democrats? Get your Democrats in line. This is a state that went to a Democrat for the first time since 1996 in a presidential election. That should count for something. The fact that Arizonans voted for Biden in this election tells you a lot. There is a lot of political cachet there. You have to use it. And Kyrsten Sinema is not using it at all. She is not responding to her constituents at all. And she's not responding to the people, and she's not allowing for the agenda that her own constituents voted for to be passed. So what is that? That again is undemocratic. You're absolutely right. I mean, undemocratic meaning you're not in the Democratic Party anymore.
Yeah, and again, it's not like she's the only one, but, and I've said this 1,000 times, Joe Manchin has never claimed to be a progressive. He has never claimed to be anything other than the thing that he is. But she very much did, and not 30 years ago in San Francisco, like now. The tweets are still there. And I wanna do something. If you can, come along with me on this journey. Forget everything that you know about campaign finance and the Supreme Court and all of that. And I wanna read a graphic, okay? We're gonna jump ahead slightly to the director. It says this, the government watchdog group Accountable.us estimates that Sinema has received at least $923,000 in donations from industry lobbying groups that are currently working to kill or water down Democrats' reconciliation package. Okay, forget everything that you've ever heard about campaign finance and all that. They don't want the bill to hurt them. They handed her nearly $1 million and she's trying to kill the bill. But that's not bribery. How does that make any sense? I get that this is so core that it's stupid to focus on, because we know how bought so many politicians are. And we now have an ultra conservative Supreme Court with a super majority that we're not gonna be able to do anything about for literally decades potentially. She has been bribed to the tune of $1 million. Way more in general, but specifically on this bill, and that is not illegal in any way. If $150 were put in a bag and handed to her, she might get in trouble. But they donate $1 million to her, she does explicitly what they want, going against everything that she campaigned on and the will of her president, and that is not bribery. That is not gonna get her in any trouble with ethics. There's not gonna be any court case, nothing. How does any of that make any sense? That she's allowed to obviously be bribed. She's engaging in the most obvious corruption imaginable, and there will be no consequences whatsoever for it.
And nobody talks about it, right? It is approached more as sort of like, no, I don't want to lower the age of Medicare. No, I don't feel like we should raise taxes on, you know, the top wealth earners. Like, just, I'm not feeling it. Like, you have to meet, I'm a moderate, meet me in the middle. There is nothing moderate about being bribed off, right? And I think that the ease at which we see someone who phones in their job, like Kyrsten Sinema, like being in the Senate, and how powerful of a position that is, and yet how easy it is to buy off a senator, is a wake-up call to all of us. And it should remind us that actually it's very easy for politicians, and we know it's not just Kyrsten Sinema, to be bought off. That's mostly what they do. Most people don't even pay attention to what they're doing, right? But suddenly, when you have people in Congress who are now saying, hey, guess what? I don't take fossil fuel money and I don't take big pharma money. They're setting the bar. So I think the more pressure we put on our new elected officials, people who are running for office, there is nothing that matters more on your platform than do you take corporate donations or not? Yeah. And from whom?
Like, you're 100% right. I'm gonna read one more graphic. I'm gonna skip to the last graphic. In response to a colleague's expression of support after an NPR story detailing her family's struggles with financial hardship, Sinema, then a representative, speaking to colleagues in the Democratic cloakroom just off the House floor, deadpanned, yeah, voters love that stupid blank. They eat it up.
Gross.
And like, gross. You know, I mean, we can't even prove that that's true. We don't have the audio or whatever, but like, but why would we need that when she had a chance to raise the wages of her constituents and she, like, again, that's why I can't get past the thumbs down. She did it not realizing that it would get out. She did it knowing it would be filmed, knowing, or at least believing, that that would not hurt her odds of reelection.
She
got elected as a young progressive. Yeah.
The like, pat and the curtsy, pat Mitch McConnell, hey buddy, watch this. Watch me do your bidding. Curtsy, thumbs down.
And she's not, like, she's not at risk right now. And I know her election's not for several years, but like, is she gonna face a serious challenge? Are the Democrats gonna do anything? Like, they're doing no confidence now. Are they going to start searching for a primary challenger and start fundraising a couple years out? Because if not, then what the hell? I mean, your no confidence is literally meaningless. There's no better Democrat. There's no better Democrat in Arizona, I guess, than Kyrsten Sinema. Who supports Kyrsten Sinema? Like, have you met a person who's like, yeah, she's got my back. She's the politician I want. She's not like a random city councilwoman. She's a senator. There's actually not many of those. It's an important position. How the hell did she end up with one of those seats? And why does it feel like a guarantee that she's going to get reelected in a couple of years, despite openly spitting in the face of all of her constituents? What a sad country. Okay, we're gonna take our second break, I guess. I feel like we don't need to, but we're gonna take our second break. When we come back, we're gonna mix it up, talk about the border, talk about this amazing reporting about the Trump administration and Julian Assange after this. I'm finding out in the Twitch chat, Francesca, that someone from the Lincoln Project disagreed with you about something.
Oh yeah, we were having a little bit of a back and forth.
Yeah.
She was doing the whole like the filibuster. What happens when Republicans are in power? And that was trash. She also did not like my take on the Iron Dome situation. You know, I just felt like putting the government of Israel's needs and wants over, like, you know, American people's needs and wants was just like kind of hypocritical at this time. But you know.
Yep. No, she also had
let's be real. Let's be real, okay? Let's talk about it. She had like one of those like, is it wine o'clock yet signs next to her. No. And I was like, dead no. Giveaway that you got no taste. JK, please have me back on that show.
That's true. No, it's the perfect Lincoln Project thing. It's like, yeah, we don't like Trump. He's bad. Also, we should maintain the institutional advantages that let nothing challenge the status quo. Yeah, that's pretty much what you guys are about. So that actually works. Okay, that said, we got a lot to get to in the remainder of this first hour. So let's jump to this. Last Friday, President Biden vowed that following the footage of Border Patrol agents on horses appearing to whip Haitian migrants, that they would pay for it, that it was horrible to see, and that he would do something following an investigation. We'll see about that. After all, this was his Border Patrol almost a year into his administration. But that said, even his mild criticism, his substance-free criticism, is too much for some people, because now Republicans are coming out to support the agents whipping the migrants. Here's the first, you might recognize him.
Tens of thousands of illegal immigrants have overrun our borders in recent days while laughing in the faces of our Border Patrol agents. And they're going after the riders of the horses, not the people that came in illegally. Isn't that incredible? And they've just put them under watch. They're in big trouble, the riders of those horses. Most people would say they were doing one hell of a job, right? Don't you think?
Well, yeah, that's gonna get a nice cheer from the Trump crowd. Yeah. So again, this is like, do we need to dive into the deplorables thing again? This isn't, you know, it's excessive, but I really do think we need to take seriously the situation at the border. No, this is find the people who did the worst, most violent stuff. The white supremacists. Just, we got Haitian migrants coming in. We should literally be whipping them, and you take those people and lift them up. That is what this movement is. It's not some sort of accident. This isn't, you know, with considerations for context. I mean, no, this is, we got to find the people that are doing the most racist stuff we can find and lift those people up. They are the true victims, the people who are fleeing horrible circumstances that we have historically contributed to. They're the aggressors. How great are the people wielding the whips?
Super awkward for the Blacks for Trump in the background. I was just like, ooh.
Was it awkward?
I think some of them were like, okay, yeah. I mean, there's just, it stings a little bit, you know? I'm not saying people don't have agency and they're not there. I'm sure they're there by their own will and volition, and that is fine. But damn, you know, and it's sad. It's hashtag sad. That's all I have to say about that.
They know what crowd they're in. They're in a crowd of people that, like, what percentage of that crowd, like, on some level, gets off on the idea of a Black person being whipped? Honestly.
Yeah.
Do you think it's less than 75%? Honestly, they loved it. They cheered for it. They had it. I don't need to do hypotheticals. They could have booed Trump. Hey, and it's not like they never boo him. Remember when he encouraged them to get vaccinated like a month ago? They booed him.
They boo him, yeah.
So they will disagree with him if they want to, if they disagree with him. They do not disagree with him on this.
Yeah, you're right.
The Border Patrol needs to whip non-white people more than they are. That is what they are being very clear about. And it is not just them. I mean, it's not just Trump. Governor Greg Abbott said the fault for any misbehavior should be placed on Biden and members of his administration because they didn't keep the Haitian migrants from crossing from Mexico into Del Rio, Texas. So Biden is responsible, which, by the way, yeah, he is responsible for continuing a lot of the horrendous policies of the Trump administration. He didn't literally wield the whip, but he has allowed them to continue doing most of the nonsense they were doing while Trump was president. But Greg Abbott goes on to say, if he, Biden, takes any action against them whatsoever, I have worked side by side with those Border Patrol agents. I want them to know something. If they are at risk of losing their job by a president who is abandoning his duty to secure the border, you have a job in the state of Texas. I will hire you to help Texas secure our border. So he'll word it a little bit differently than a Donald Trump. But he will, again, it is lifting up the worst of the worst and saying those are our people. It is reassuring the base that there is no act too barbaric, too racist that gets you written off by this team. You are a member of the team because you're doing those things.
Yeah. And hey, we'll recruit you to our new, you know, vigilante little like border squad here. The KKK team, and you know, have at it, whatever. We'll give you all the whips that you want. We'll give you all the horses that you need. This is fine by us. And look, the reality is that Biden's on their side. because this was his border patrol. This was under his DHS. And guess what else? He's continuing deporting Haitians en masse back to a very unstable country. There's no plan for asylum. There's no plan to help people in the midst of a pandemic, earthquake fallout, political fallout in that country. No, Biden's on their side, but no one, and certainly not this show, is gonna praise him for that. But if Republicans were honest, Biden is doing exactly what they want, which is deporting migrants. I believe they should be able to seek asylum. That is actually in lockstep with US law, which has been suspended because of the pandemic, and Biden refuses to undo the Title 42 stipulations. So, you know, it's a sad state because there's nothing that will suffice for right wingers bloodlust when it comes to the border. Nothing is good enough, right? Well, why didn't they have two whips? Why didn't they have chains? You know, that's what they want. That they want more bodies dead on the border. They want to celebrate that because somehow trying to seek a better life for your family is in and of itself a crime, even though their ancestors, their forefathers, all our forefathers, unless you were Native American, came here seeking that exact same betterment of their lives.
And whether, like, we know that sometimes Biden's like horrified of doing something because he might get criticized. So sometimes I speculate that he's doing things so that he will get credit. Like, he's not getting credit for continuing this. And it's possible that that's not why he's doing it. He's just doing it because this is what Democratic presidents do. They are barbaric at the border. That's a continuation of, you know, you can go back to Obama, you can go back to Clinton. But again, like, the right wing doesn't care. Like, you're giving them exactly what they want. The Haitian migrants were being whipped, but they, like, so they have to still criticize him, even though he's doing exactly what they want. Insane. Anyway, let's go to this last video very briefly. See, I think Trump had a little more to say about what's happening at the border.
The police are saying, you know, what do we do? This is an invasion.
They still believe the wall thing. After 4 years of him as president, they're gonna do the reruns, you know? Just play back the hits, I guess. And as many people have pointed out, you know, on podcasts and things like that, they get even more explicit, saying that this is not just an invasion that is organic. It's being brought in by elites here. It's the sort of conspiratorial nonsense that has resulted in mass shootings. But they are going right back into it again because they don't care. That is not a problem from their point of view.
Yeah.
Any final thoughts on this before we move on?
No, just lastly, I think we're at a crossroads in this country, right? Because you see how easy it is to whip up this kind of racist hate when things aren't going your way, right? And I think that the thing, I'm like, you need to distract them. You need to jangle new keys in front of these folks who are just so ready to hate one another. And to me, the keys are like, hey, how about healthcare and a job and like stopping climate change and your home doesn't get flooded? Ding a ding a ding a ding. And that sucks, you know what I mean? That's because, like, what I actually want to do is, like, y'all need to go to some kind of, you know, racial sensitivity training slash, you know, re-education camp. Obviously, I'm gonna get quoted on that, but no, it is hard. And you're like, I don't know how to make you stop being awful. And my answer is, you need to stop blaming migrants for issues in your own community that have everything to do with the rich and powerful taking more than their fair share and nothing to do with asylum seekers trying to, you know, live.
He's not calling for like a more robust energy grid in Texas to protect them from freezing to death. He's not, I criticize the myth of right wing populism a lot. How many of these candidates do we have to watch before we can conclude that no, there's nothing about, it's not populist. It's not,
it doesn't exist.
Xenophobia. It is not a thing. They're not delivering anything. They say, oh, I hear you. You've been ignored. I hear you, and I will give you the same xenophobia we've always given you. It's not a different thing. Stop. Oh, God, it's such a stupid myth. Anyway, with that said, we are running low on time and we have an important story to get to. So why don't we launch directly into it? Apparently, the Trump administration wanted to kill that man, Julian Assange, at least kidnap him, possibly assassinate him. And this is the result of a Yahoo News investigation that spoke with 30 former US officials. And the details are pretty rough. So back in 2017, this is the first year of the Trump administration, as Julian Assange began his fifth year hold up at Ecuador's embassy in London, the CIA plotted to kidnap him, spurring a heated debate among Trump administration officials over the legality and practicality of such an operation. I love the idea that the CIA is like having a debate over the legality of things. That's quaint. Anyway, some senior officials inside the CIA and the Trump administration even discussed killing Assange, going so far as to request sketches or options for how to assassinate him. Discussions over kidnapping or killing Assange occurred, quote, at the highest levels of the Trump administration, said a former senior counterintelligence official, quote, there seem to be no boundaries. Well, yeah, it's the CIA and it's the Trump administration. I don't think they're that concerned about international norms of conduct and whether it's legal or whatever. So they were considering kidnapping him, they were considering killing him. We'll have more details, Francesca, but what do you make of this?
Terrifying and awful and yet surprising and not surprising at the same time. Surprising because, you know, remember when Trump loved WikiLeaks? WikiLeaks found all these dumps. And like, in fact, right, we know that Assange did reach out to Don Trump Jr. Like that happened. Sorry, bro. And like, look, I have a lot of disagreements with where Assange has gone in the last few years. Obviously, he has been under duress. He's been under house arrest, literally. And you know, he is not well and he should be allowed to, you know, actually not be immediately extradited to the United States. I think that ship is sailed, obviously. But I have a lot of problems with how he was treated over the years. This feels crazy to me because of the way that Trump was lauding WikiLeaks and Julian Assange during the entire campaign. I guess if they ever got help from him, then that was it. Then now they just are willing to just assassinate him. And I'm obviously, that is awful and cruel, and but par for the course on this guy.
Well, I mean, so there's this Vault 7 hack that WikiLeaks did, the largest data loss in CIA history, they're saying. So it feels to me more like the CIA wants revenge or to stop him from doing this in the future. And the Trump administration was perfectly willing to go along with it. Now, they didn't kidnap him, they didn't kill him. Let's be clear about that. It doesn't make sense to me that Trump would be the impetus for it, that he would want this to happen, but he certainly seemed to allow the discussion to go forward. And it's obviously insane. We have a pretty robust history of being against the CIA internationally killing people, which I wish was a more common position to be against that. But anyway, I'll say what I always say when stories like this come up, stop trying to kidnap him. Stop trying to kill him. Let us work towards a place, a time where we never have to hear his name again. How about that? Let him just be free to try to get fascist Republicans elected president of the United States and not be assassinated for it. How about that? That's a future we should work towards.
What do you think? John, I agree with you. And I know we're gonna get hounded for this, but I totally agree with you. Like, the enemy of my enemy is not my friend. I do not agree with either the CIA or some of Assange's worst tendencies. Yeah. I do think his greatest tendencies, you know, getting Chelsea Manning's story out there, are wonderful, right? But it proves once again, Trump doesn't care. He has no loyalties. There's no even bribing him off. He has no object permanence. He will forget that you tried to bribe him yesterday. Literally, if you don't bribe him Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, by Thursday, he's like, what happened? So anyway.
We'll see. Yeah, I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see how some outlets cover this, because there's this weird confluence of wanting to stick up rightfully for Assange not being murdered or kidnapped and never wanting to criticize the Trump administration. It feels like a rock in a hard place sort of situation here. But anyway, still opposed to international assassinations. Let's not do that. Anyway, thank you to all of you watching on our linear platform. We are running out of our first hour, but there is a lot more news to come. So if you're watching on Twitch or if you're watching on YouTube, we've got more stories, including an update on the pandemic and a bunch of nonsense involving Marjorie Greene and Rudy Giuliani and a bunch of other ghouls. So you got that to look forward to after this.
Thanks for listening to the full episode of The Damage Report. Support our work, listen ad-free, access members-only bonus content, and more by subscribing to Apple Podcasts at apple.co/TYT. I'm your host, John Adirola. I'll see you soon.